Hi, I'm Céline Amier, and today I'm going to present you some recent data that I've got showing that the circular organization in the medial frontal cortex provides insights into primate brain evolution. So why studying sulci? To my point of view, there is three main reasons. The first one is that the organization of sulci is absolutely not arbitrary. If we look at, for example, here, what is the topic of interest of the present talk, that is the medial wall, you can see here that it's characterized mainly by two sulci, the cingulate sulcus that is there in all hemispheres, and the paracingulate sulcus here in pink that is there only in about 70% of subjects, at least in one hemisphere. It's a secondary sulcus occurring early, later in utero. And if you look at what's going on in the macaque, you can see also that this cingulate sulcus is present in all hemispheres. The second reason is that all my work from the past 15 years converged toward the fact that sulci are pertinent to function. And I show you here one specific example of this region. We have seen that this region that is located at the intersection with the posterior vertical paracingulate sulcus here and the paracingulate sulcus if present or with the cingulate sulcus, if the paracingulate sulcus is absent, contains the face motor representation of the cingulate motor area, the anterior one. So you can access this by with fMRI, asking the subject to perform face movement, like eye movement or tongue movement. And this is also the locus of activity of the region involved in the analysis of visual and joyous feedback, specifically in exploratory situation. So it's when you are in a trial and error learning, you have to interpret the feedback that you've got to adjust appropriately your behavior in the next trials. So this region is involved in the analysis of visual and joyous feedback in this specific context. And this is interesting to have a look on what's going on in macaque, where we know that this region that seems to correspond, anatomically speaking, is also, you also find here feedback-related activity, joyous feedback-related activity. So this is the dorsal bank of the cingulate sulcus. This is a meta-analysis of electrophysiological and anatomical studies. And here is the frequency. The more reddish, the higher papers showing activity, feedback-related activity in this region here. And you can see that this region here coincide with this one here that correspond to the eye face motor representation. So you have to imagine this line within the dorsal bank of the cingulate sulcus here. So this means that the functional organization of the mid-cingulate cortex can be predicted from local morphology in human and is well preserved from macaque to human. And the third reason for assessing sulci is the goal of my talk today is to show you that the organization of sulci may be used as a tool to understand primate brain evolution. And to assess this, we analyzed the anatomical T1 MRI data of 197 human brains from the Human Connectome Project, 225 chimpanzee brain from collaboration with Bill Hopkins in US, 88 baboons brain thanks to a collaboration with Adrien Megardici in France, and 80 rhesus macaques from our lab and our collaborators. If we look at now what's going on in the dorsomedial frontal cortex, this blue region here, the first thing that we have seen is that the paracingulate sulcus, which was thought to be a human-specific sulcus, is in fact not, because we observe this sulcus also in chimpanzee, as you can observe here. Two main differences can be, however, observed. First, in human, we observe this sulcus in about 70% of subjects, at least in one hemisphere, and this percentage falls to 34% in chimpanzee. And the second one is that it's lateralized on the left hemisphere in human, but it's equally present in the left and right hemisphere in chimpanzee. So now if you look at the vertical sulci that are present in this region, we can see that they are present as sulci in both human and chimp. And in baboon and macaque, we observe the precursors of sulci that we call spur or dimple, depending on the shape of it. And if we look at the occurrence of these vertical sulci in all species, we can see that the paracentral sulcus here, the most posterior one, is almost equally present in human and chimp. And equally present in baboon and macaque, but the frequency of occurrence is lower in old world monkeys than in hominids. And if we look at now the morphology of these precursor of sulci or sulci, you can see that in human and chimp, they are all sulci. In baboon, they are most often the spurs and dimple, and most often dimple than spur in macaque. If we look at now the preparasumpal sulcus that is there, you can see that it's again equally present in human and chimp and equally present in baboon and macaque, but with a difference between these hominides and old world monkeys' brain. We observe the same morphology pattern with the fact that this sulcus is a sulcus in human and chimp and a spur in baboon and a dimple in macaque. The posterior vertical paracingulate sulcus here is it's almost there in all hemispheres in human. It falls a bit in chimp, and it's less there in baboon and macaque. And the morphology, we can see that it's similar to the other sulci. And the anterior vertical paracingulate sulcus here, we can see a linear decrease of the frequency of occurrence across these four species and the same morphological feature. Now, if we look at so this means that macaques do possess all the precursors of the human vertical sulci in the dorsomedial frontal cortex. And now if we look at where they are localized, this vertical sulci, it was really interesting because we saw that the paracentral sulcus is always found at the level of the rostral limit of the pons here. So this is observed when you have orientate the brain so that the anterior commissure, posterior commissure line is horizontal and you are in template. That is the MNI template in human, the chimpanzee template in chimpanzee. In baboon, it's a template developed by Adrien Mergadichian. And in macaque, it's the MNI template here. So here is the density of occurrence of the vertical sulci, where we find the vertical sulci is the difference between the anteroposterior Y value where we find this rostral limit of the pons and where we find the intersection between the pacs and the cingulate sulcus or the paracingulate sulcus if present. And you can see that it's tightly linked to the peak of occurrence of the paracentral sulcus occurs at the level of the rostral limit of the pons. The preparacentral sulcus, we observe the same thing, but it's observed at the level of the anterior commissure. The posterior vertical paracingulate sulcus always falls at the caudal limit of the journey of the corpus callosum, and the anterior vertical paracingulate sulcus falls at the level of the rostral limit of the journey of the corpus callosum. So this means that the vertical sulci are located at anatomical landmarks that all primates possess. So now if we look at what's going on in the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, this region is characterized by three main sulci. The superior rostral sulcus, that seems to be a very old structure, and it's there in all primate species, in all hemispheres, in 100% of hemispheres, in all these species. Sorry. If we look at now the inferior rostral sulcus, so this is a secondary sulcus, so it's not there in all hemispheres in human. But you can see that it's present in human and chimp equally, and it's equally present in baboon and macaque, so almost no present here. So we have again this difference between hominides and old world monkeys. And the final one is the accessory susorbitalis sulcus here, where we see a big difference between human and chimp on one side and baboon and macaque on the other side. So this means that, and importantly, all these sulci in this region are sulci, even in macaques. We do not observe spur and dimple. So now, take a look at what's going on at the intersection between the dorsal and the ventral medial prefrontal cortex here. And this is the region that really display strong differences. So this region is characterized as following. In human, we have a fork that hands rostrally the cingulate sulcus. And this fork is formed by the susorbitalis sulcus here and the supraostral sulcus here. When a paracingulate sulcus is present, this fork is most often located at the end of the paracingulate sulcus. And this fork is always pointing downward, like this. What's going on in chimpanzee? In chimpanzee, we observe this pattern. So the fork is looking downward, that is represented here in pink, in most of the hemisphere. But in some hemisphere, about 20% here, the fork is it's forward facing like this. So now if we look at what's going on in baboon and macaque, we have more different patterns. We have this pattern where the fork is looking, is ending by a complete fork and pointing downward. And you can see the linear decrease of occurrence of this type of pattern from human to macaque. We see that the fork can be forward facing, like in a chimpanzee. We can also see that in some hemisphere, the fork is incomplete with only the stus orbitalis sulcus. And in some brain, there is no fork at the end. So what we observe is that there is a gradient from macaque to human where the fork becomes more complete and the fork points more downward. And this is, we can have a look on where is exactly located this fork. And to do so, we looked at the difference between the dorsoventral Z value where we find the apex of the journey of the corpus callosum here and where we find the fork, and we looked at the difference. And you can see that in human, this fork is really close to the apex of the journey of the corpus callosum. But in all non-human primate, the other one, chimp, with the chimp included, this fork is located dorsally to the apex of the journey of the corpus callosum. And we do not see differences between chimp, baboon, and macaque. So this suggests that specifically in human, the fork is pushed downward. And this is concomitant with two morphological aspect. First, there is the appearance of a new sulcus in human, that is this one, the rostroperpendicular paracingulate sulcus, probably reflecting the expansion of Orion 9. And this is also concomitant with the full setup of the dorsomedial and ventromedial polar sulci that can be seen here, dorsomedial and ventromedial, that we think delimitate area 10. And you can see that it's there in human. It's there also, the dorsomedial polar sulcus is there in chimpanzee, but in 50% of hemisphere. And almost not, the ventromedial polar sulcus is almost not there, and it's almost absent in baboon and macaque, both of them. So to conclude, what the analysis of sulcal patterns told us, it told us that the dorsomedial frontal cortex and the ventromedial prefrontal cortex are well preserved from macaque to human, but that major changes occur at the junction between these two regions. In addition, we have seen that the sulcal organization is tightly linked to function in the dorsomedial frontal cortex in both macaque and human. It's also the case for the ventromedial prefrontal cortex. I didn't present this data, but you can have a look on this paper to see the details. So to conclude, because sulci relate to function in both human and macaque, the anatomofunctional organization of the entire medial frontal cortex may be understood across species thanks to sulci, even in species for which we do not have MRI anatomical data. And to conclude, I would like to thank all my collaborators in US, in Canada, and in France, and my lab, obviously, the people in my lab that are really supportive, and all the grant agencies that supported this work. Thanks a lot.